First.
I've seen his
birth. Yeah, it's just a convenient. What we have here. So we built this. This is all designed and built in Taiwan, right? So this is a testing platform for any kind of disease in animals and human.
Mm-hmm.
So.
I saw it. It's cost like $9,000 per piece.
Could be.
Yeah.
Could be made for that. But so these are lateral flow assays, right? So you can do these for any kind of disease, whether it's HIV or. But now it's COVID, right?
Yeah.
So it's basically a machine that you develop these kind of assays, and then you just very quickly read it. But the key point is that this is connected. It's an internet connect, cloud connect. You use AWS, right? So we also have the smart card reader for the Taiwan National Health Insurance card.
Okay.
Yeah.
So it speaks Wi-Fi?
Yeah, Wi-Fi and LAN.
And LAN.
Yeah, and LAN
okay.
is both, right?
Right.
So this can be connected. So and we're collecting data from all these testing that are coming
okay.
in. The question for you is how to collaborate with the government about the data and reporting, because this is both CDC and the FDA, and this is national security, and this is animal health, you know, because we can detect African swine fever and other diseases as well. Right?
Have you talked to CDC? That's entirely CDC's discretion.
Right.
Yeah.
But for them, it's all about, do you follow the rules, do you
That's
follow
right.
the regulation?
Uh-huh.
I'm thinking more on the reporting side, like once you have all this data, how do you aggregate it and how you make the data useful?
For the participant or for academic researchers or just for anybody?
Yeah, for anybody.
For anybody.
Or for government in general. What kind of collaboration do you think we can do?
Okay, I don't really think there's government in general here, because
okay.
this is the data that's interesting to public health researchers, but that's one part only.
Yeah.
It could also be a group of individuals that want to learn more about themselves,
sure.
essentially, about each other. And these are different privacy implications and architecture. One is more on the statistics side, and one is more on the academic research, and also just personal data sovereignty side. And so, do you have any collaboration in either of these two shapes in other countries or in some other jurisdictions?
Yeah. So in Europe, we're working in Europe with WHO now to become their machine vendor.
Sure.
Because they have a lot of test kits, but they don't have a machine yet.
I see.
And we also have an office in the U.S. So it's designed and built in Taiwan by us. But, so we're working with all these test kit vendors that are making, now it's COVID-19, but they have a lot of, there's 200 other types of diseases that they can test for.
Okay.
So it's a pretty big database of results. Yeah, so one thing is security. We have this, I think every hospital should have one of these devices. Every research facility, every lab should have one of these
just
devices.
Just one?
I mean, multiple.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. No. So I think it's very useful, right? So now we're just getting FDA approval. Hopefully this month. So we've been waiting for a couple months.
The U.S. FDA.
Taiwan FDA.
The TFDA.
And U.S. FDA
TFDA.
Afterwards.
Okay.
Yeah. And also applied for CE IVD, which is a European equivalent.
Yeah. Okay.
We passed all the regulatory, the CE, FCC, all this stuff is done. Now we're just waiting for regulatory approval.
Okay, so just to make sure that I understand the tech.
Yes.
So once it produces the results, it speaks over Wi-Fi and LAN to Amazon Web Service hosted in somewhere in this region.
Singapore, US, whatever.
Japan, whatever.
Yeah.
And then what? I mean, you control the entire cloud infrastructure, or your partners?
Yeah, we rent the cloud space.
Sure, you rent the cloud space. You wrote the access control and so on.
Right.
But what's, for example, WHO in which you're a partner?
Yeah.
So of course they'll ask for a copy, preferably in real time of this data.
Right.
And then you just copy it to them, and then they do whatever. Is that the idea?
Yeah, so you're the perfect guy. So, so you know what it takes to write some data data analytics, right?
Sure.
Yeah. So it's not it's not, you have to give an API access, and then somebody has to write all the maps and the demographics to get all the data out, right?
Yeah, but I mean, is this API already public? Do you have API definition and things
yes,
like that?
Yeah,
okay. Right, so if I'm a developer in the WHO, I don't really have to get your consent or anything. I just write toward that API and you just flag my incoming IP address or whatever as a like reading a reader,
give
a reader,
keys,
right?
Give
a key, and then the data pipeline just runs by itself.
Yeah. Right.
Okay.
So then that's for reporting, right?
Uh-huh.
So that can be done by geolocation based reporting. Yeah. So I think it would be very useful to have access to this stuff. So do you have any suggestion for government or if we're in Taiwan specifically, mm-hmm. how you can?
Well, in Taiwan, we have a personal data management platform called the My Data, that's maintained by the National Human Council. But in this particular case, it's actually operated by the National Health Insurance Administration, the NHIA.
Okay.
And the NHIA has this app. I don't know whether you've tried it. Right. So the app recently got a kind of overhaul in interface. And it actually now contains the ability to display in the one-time QR code in lieu of a actual IC health card, so that one can also in a like a video conference and telehealth scenario use that app to authorize, just like swiping a national health card. So that functionality is quite useful in like multi-party reporting scenarios because it's cumbersome to keep inserting your NHI card.
Right.
And the same app also has a functionality where you can download all the X-ray scans, dentist and doctor visits or whatever that's written into the health bank. But the health bank isn't just about health insurance bank, but rather about like there's people with diabetes and their similar monitoring machines runs into their health bank. And then they can then authorize third-party software developers to then use that into a, for example, a group measurement or a group-oriented feedback mechanism to those braces or whatever other things that they're wearing. So that becomes a positive loop for the people who join this sort of data collection. And so if you check out the NHIA's SDK page, you get a list of the current ecosystem players. I don't know whether you're already
with them. Yeah, we looked at that because we developed National Health Insurance Card support for the machine, right?
Yeah, of course.
So now we're using the non-encrypted part of it.
Yeah.
So now I'm wondering how we
just the ID card or something, the ID number.
Yeah, just the number, the ARC number, birth date, and and there's a number, serial number for the card.
Yeah.
So what do you suggest we do to get to maybe get more the actual test because it's privacy concerns, right?
Right, but the SDK users they already has their privacy policies because it's a whitelist that's whitelisted by the NHIA. So my suggestion and many of them are actually established hospitals. So or hospital alliances. So instead of just applying for the SDK access yourself, which could be quite cumbersome time-wise, perhaps you can join one of the existing SDK licensees who already have the access keys to get authorization by individuals to join their data collection, so that you can read and write to the health bank from the like the pre-cleared use of one of those SDK players. The list I can't memorize it, but it's on the NHI webpage.
Okay, great.
Yeah.
Do you have one in particular you would suggest?
No, I don't. I really don't. Okay. The government, basically, in this case, makes sure that the consent, the informed consent, as well as the data aggregation, is safe cybersecurity-wise.
Okay.
But we don't have preferred vendors as such, right? We really want any new ideas to get into the partnership of the existing ecosystem instead of just saying, you know, we'll favor one because there's no ecosystem otherwise.
Of course, yes.
Yeah.
I understand. Okay, great. All right. Yeah, good. Good advice.
We have a annual presidential hackathon, and that's that's when many of these novel collaborations get to prove their merits because the top five teams in each year's hackathon get a presidential promise that their idea will become national policy within the next 12 months. And so last year, for example, the Ministry of Health and Welfare has a team that couples the, I think it's, the direction of the sun and the wind and the temperature and so on, and measure the likeliness of getting heat damage. Okay. And then through a app, for example, mm-hmm. the one that from Circuit Plus that reminds you to get your bottles refilled in nearby drinking fountains. Okay. And then that is a nudge, right? Whenever mm-hmm. there's unexpected surge in head damage, they steer people toward possible refilling points and remind people to drink more and form a habit instead of buying new plastic bottles and so on. So we're looking for that sort of social design and social mm-hmm. collaboration that can also prove there's a public benefit to the individual participation, not just the financial incentives, not just the incentives of understanding oneself better, but actually something that's also pro-social so that it can spread more, that people would willingly contribute the data more. So that's the general direction of the past presidential hackathons.
Okay. Cool. So how can we invite it to this?
Yeah, anyone can apply their ideas. I think we're launching in less than a month.
Okay.
Right? So just check out Presidential Hackathon.
All right. Yeah. Sounds good.
Can I ask some questions? Mm-hmm.
Yes, I
have a question. Yes. There are three ideas. One idea is, if we have the Taiwan government, we have ID 跟我们的健保卡放在一起，
那一起是手机上而已嘛？
对，是手机上嘛。那我们要讲的是说，那像我们现在在，如果是从以后如果变成这事情常态性，因为像911那件事情造成的说，以后你到要去飞机场之前，你要过海关之前，你都必须要先去做一个那种安全的那个检测，就是说到你要全部什么危险用品啊，各式各样的东西。那如果说未来 COVID 这件事情，它以后会造成更多的就是流行的那种传染病的一个状态下，那它以后也会变成说是固定的常态。那它有没有可能会是用另外一种用，也是让它结合用那个 passport，
那你的接种跟检测记录全部都在健康存折里啊？现在已经是这样了。
那是我们台湾，可是那如果海外的人？在讲的就是海外的人，
可是刚刚他也是说 ARC number，
对啊，我在讲 ARC number，
对，其实 ARC number 也可以用健保卡，我们有很多移工都是用健保卡来买。
可是他刚来的呢，如果像他那时候刚来还没有办法，就是他才刚过来，他还没有说满多少天，他还没有那些健保卡的那一段时间，那一段的空窗的那一段呢？
这当然可以讨论了。好比方说就业金卡，也有很多人觉得说他拿 Go Card 来，他想要一落地就申请健保，
对，
有点像是不会开车，在美国也有 driver license 是一样的道理。我的意思是这样子，
比如说这一段是比较那种的，我就跟他讲说，我们台湾有这个耶，然后他就说，那难道不能补给吗？我们在讲就是这一段，那是因为我们台湾在讲台湾。可是问题是，如果放眼在世界上的话，那每一个国家有每一个国家的一个游戏规则。可是那如何去做到一个普及的一个状态下，如何让？
不过为什么一定要人家来用我们的 app？ 不是只要互通就好？
我没有要用 app，
对啊，
我是说的意思是说互通。
对啊，
我在讲，因为这又讲到了中国，像在中国的时候呢，如果说我们今天跟对方讲说，我的 app 跟你的 app 想要用。
对啊，
那 OK， 可是你要做交换的那个资讯，他又不愿意。他说你是不是要从我这儿捞资料？我说不用，你就是给我做一个防火墙，我到哪里的时候就不会的人。他说我怎么知道你会捞我的？
可是我刚刚的意思是说，如果两边都让那个使用者自己可以下载自己的资料，这叫资料可惜性嘛？
对，
对，那这样的话，其实这两边不用彼此认得啊。从我的角度来看，我是下载了资料传输到第三方嘛？
啊，我懂你的意思，
对啊，
我懂你的意思。
而事实上也只能这样子，
对，
因为
彼此都对彼此有一个，因为他们两个等于是两个 app 对的，以 app 来说就两个 app 对的，
对啊，
我怎么可以不让你捞我的
？Exactly， 对，因为事实上你只能让那个行为人自己。说哦，我看过了，确实是我这个资料没错的，我也觉得没错，他也觉得没错，那我们两个都觉得没错的交给他，那所以是靠着他跟这个 app 跟他跟那个 app 中间的互信来维系嘛，而不是说这两个 app 的开发者彼此的互信。
啊，我因为我那时候我就在跟他讲，我中间少了一个点，
对对对，
我说我少了一个点，我那个点我没有找出来，然后就是我们在讲的是那一个点，就是你刚刚在这样说的，然后说那等于是要下载的那一个人，他还要就用一个云端，或者说他要
有一个，没有，你可以看一下，我们有一个叫做 My Data， 它就是让人可以一键式的。 就好比像我到银行要申办一个开户，他需要我在不同的部会的资料，那他回到 MyData， 但是就是有点像是 single sign on 那样子，他就立刻就资料就串过去，所以我们把这个程序做得很简单，但是概念上仍然是我先下载再上传，
上传对对对，是一样，
对，但不是真的我下载一个什么档案，而是说我下载上传是同一个动作。
哦，对，因为我在讲，就是在讲说，哎，那我们这样子的话，那我那天才在跟他讲说，哎，那 我今天就不存在这个问题啊。嗯、那如果你把我们台湾的这个游戏规则让全世界都能这样使用的话，我觉得是没有问题啊。但他就这样跟我讲说，没有啊，可是在美国，他们的那种贫富悬殊非常大的时候，就不是每一个人可以用这样的
东西。我同意，我同意，但就是说 MyData 这个概念，只要大家都使用，那这样的话，这个中间的串接就变得很简单。我们不需要把我们的这套做法给美国，我们只需要把这一套做法那个 protocol 就是 API 啦，公开出来。那所以我刚才一下就问说，哎，它 API 是不是公开的？因为两边都是公开的话，你就算 API 长得不一样，你也可以好像一个110伏到220伏的电源转换器那样，中间写一个 adapter， 一个 API adapter 就可以串起来了。
因为你现在在讲 adapter， 那就是另外一个话题，因为你讲的一个就是我们。那是明年度又要去做的事情，就是那明年度要去做的，就是因为我那天在跟他讲，哎、欸，其实省电装置这件事情，我在讲的是，就是在牵扯到我们当时在写那个
节能啊，
节能的这一块的时候，就又进来讲这件事情。然后我就跟他讲说，哎、欸，我们在讲节能，所以他在这一台上面，他也会做这一件事情。他就跟我说，哎、欸，我没有要存任何的资料，我不需要那么大量的电力啊，我就只要微电流这样就可以了。对，那我说好，那跳过，我就跟他讲，没关系，那我们就进入下一个。他说没有，我 focus 要在这，我说但我要先跟你讲，我要先把这资料准备好，下一个我们要去做这件事情的时候会比较。
那、啊、所以这个是用电池哦。
它有电池，然后也有、哦、它里面没有电池。因为他是为了要携带方便，然后他怕说有一些国家他是不能带着
锂电池什么的，
所以他就干脆把它拆了，所以他就想说这边有电池，
电源供应器，
对，
然后是可以带上锂机的。
I see.
Power adapter for.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. If you use for for the place you don't have power, you can use 24 hours.
Ah, okay. Yeah. Wow, that's pretty good.
But without any, we can have solar panel or there's a satellite uplink.
Yeah, one of those, you know, indoor solar panels that will work perfectly.
Right. So, yeah.
对，那这部分就是我刚刚讲的，说我就说我不管你在做什么事情，我还是希望以走在比较前面为主。虽然难了一点，我也会推慢一点，可是好处是说在未来上面你可以看得比较久远一点。这是第一点。然后第二点是我们在讲另外一件事情，是说我才会跟他讲说，因为这样子，我说你先有这个概念，我们先有这个概念之后，我们去做下一步的时候会比较简单。他说有现在这一步是在做医疗，我说我知道，可是万法不离周，游戏规则还是一样。然后我就跟他讲，对，我就说那今天你还是要就是这个方向去走。我说因为你台湾不用讲台湾，全世界未来会面临就是一个人口爆炸，再来面临的就会是不管是气候暖化，我说就光人口爆炸这件事情就会引发太多太多的问题。我说咱们就讲再讲人口爆炸抢的是什么，抢的就是能源。
了解，知道你的意思。
对，然后我就说，哎，那你要不要先做一下节能啊？然后你要不要做一下能源？他说节能，他是能源是有限，我说对，能源有限，可是自然是无限。
了解，了解。
那要不要从自然上面下手？对，然后他就说呢，我说，就光以四个方向来，我说对不起，我不是工程师，我只能告诉你我所看到，我所得到
的。有大的趋势了。
对，我说，然后我就跟他讲这件事情的时候，我就说，那我就讲，我们就不用讲什么，我们就光讲电来说的话，我说就以。他那天在跟德国在谈的过程当中，他说光线损这件事情就会发生很大
啊，对，当然，
对，因为在中国我就已经遇上，
就传输的那个距离，对，
对，第一个传输距离当中只要有波折或是不够稳定，当中就会损耗很多的第一件事情，然后再来就是它的大电流跟转换的这一个部分也会发生的一个那种价差的问题，然后再来就是它有太多的问题，我说那你们工程师自己。然后我说其他的在跳，我说这个是电的部分，我说就又以我们瓦斯来说，就是以天然气来说，就是在3-4年前我们高雄气爆那件事情，
是，
对，我说那个部分气爆的原因，不管今天是什么，是因为天然气无法去被暖而捕捉。那为什么我们的天然气当中你会闻到说，哎，有什么那个味道？那不是天然气本身是没有味道。 那是为了要让大家知道，
知道说可能有泄露，
对，才会加这个东西。然后，但是气体温被捉，台湾现在做的东西是去跑那一个马，像马表那样的一个东西。那我说呢，是因为不能用电，因为爆。那我是不是有可能用磁性的？
知道你的意思。
对，我说，我就说，哎，这是另外一个。我就说，刚刚说你要丢那么多东西出来，我没有啊，反正你们慢慢研究好不好。然后我说，那你这个部分用这个嘛？啊，那水的部分，我说我们台湾还遇到另外一个问题，我说怎么？我说水啊，水，我们家的那个水库泥巴太多
啊，清淤对。
对，然后说清淤顺便造个电，然后说你又哪里来的想法？我说不是不是，我之前在日本做交换生的时候，曾经有发现一件事情。日本有一个东西，就是它一个螺旋，它只要在螺旋动力的时候，它能产生电。可是他就跟我讲说，哦，那个部分你需要高到低的水量。我说 no， 你知道它的那一个螺旋的一个部分的时候，他们有一个组装装置，就是你水进去的时候，你不一定要靠那么高流的那个水，
不一定要靠位能，
对。不需要，你只要就是在那机器装置的时候，让它在一个水阀上面停下来的时候，在大量冲往下冲的时候，它就会造成一直去转。可是在转的过程当中，那是不是在过程当中可以顺便清淤？在清淤的过程当中，是不是就可以产生电呢？那在这过程当中是不是有？他说你这个正在考虑的是电，那水力、电力还有那个我。啊，一举数得，但是这我不懂，我只是在讲这个概念。然后反正都有工程师，
理解理解，很有意思啊。
然后
很好玩的，
你一定要这样玩吗？我说我不知道啦，反正我先丢给你了。
是是是。
对，然后我说，那我说有没有可能往这个方向走？我说我也不知道，你可以问问看。
很棒啊。
可是我不晓得有没有可能，因为他是上次我们两个一直在吵嘛，但是吵说他就说不行，天然气不可以跟电在一起。因为我说就做节能电板嘛。他说对，节能电板。但是你知不知道，你又想把它放在天然气？我说没有没有，不一样不一样不一样。是，我说是因为我们这一个给我其他的思考逻辑。他就说，节能啊，又要干嘛干嘛？我说不，我说应该是说你能做节能电板，因为我知道，因为你会设计 IC 板，会去做这些东西，而且你把这个东西整出来，所以我知道你可以。但如果我知道说你告诉我说气泡那边遇到电会爆炸。OK， 好，那我今天不用电，不用磁力。
只知道你的意思。
对，
所以很多都是材料上面有一些新的发明啦。
对，
像说什么也有人在做把核废料装在钻石里面发电，然后又不会外泄啊等等。
对对
对，这是一些想法。
对，然后我是跟他讲说，我不是，我这个我只是提供你这样，然后但重点还是你们这些专业人要去做。
是是是是。
然后他说，那你要去想想跟评估这个可行性啊。我说对。他说你知道光这样子你要花掉，我说这不难。因为它的后期是被期待的，我相信这并不难。
对了，有些就是等这个材料从研究慢慢进入实作，它那个成本会突然下降，那个时候就是工程师进场的时候。
对，
那有些时候还在科学家那里，那这个时候工程师就比较没有用武之地。
所以我觉得好问题啊，他就说跟你们想一下，我说
是
好问题啊，我把这个拿来问好。
了解了解，
但是我在问，那这样是有可能性的吗？
我觉得很多都是在实验室，就是还在小规模。但当这个小规模它实验出来，发现这个成本真的有下降的趋势，那这个时候当然不管靠国家补助还是私人企业的赞助，这一段就是工程师最能够大展身手的时候。那到所有人都会做了，那有 commodity， 那就也就还好了。那我们就去做下一个题目，这样。
对，所以因为他们在做这个时候，我说那我要去做别的事情。
对对对。
但是你要讲说啊，反正我。
对，你就等那个成熟嘛。
对啊，这个是你们在已经在弄了，然后我已经再去看别的东西，然后看完之后我就告诉你我想要做什么东西。
对对对。
然后你们工程师再继续做，这样就好
了。对对对，我觉得这个很有意思。
对，那因为他说这样可行，应该可行吧？
就今天不可行，那也可能有一天会可行嘛。
对，不是因为他在说，因为他的好处是说
社会的需求，
这样在对答的时候可以找到一个问题出来。譬如说，像他那时候在跟我讲说，节能电板。碰到气，
对，
然后的话一定会爆，然后我就说哦，那这样子我是不是有？那我这样子的话也不能用微电表，我说不行，你这样一定会爆。
对，
那我磁性真的不行，那磁性到时候我磁性再去跟我的其他东西装置做连接的，然后我说那你要去考虑到距离问题。
是，
我说这家伙真的，我对不起，我真的不懂，我只是在想原理而已。然后我说。要问，然后所以我在说，在这个过程当中还有什么事我没有去想到？我说在这四个是，就是不管是节能电板，或是因为节能电板，我是跟他讲，我在原本的装置里面，我不要去乱改东西。 我不要去乱改，因为你一旦改就是成本。
了解。
所有人都不会愿意动。
了解。
然后我说的是，可是我看了一下太阳能来说的话，太阳能本身它是一个玻璃面去接受阿法贝塔的这一块东西。那如果是这样子的话，它靠的应该是里面怕它的那个一个里面的一个装置有问题，而并不应该跟玻璃有关。
所以
我才跟他讲说，那是不是有可能说应该是要玻璃照原本的玻璃面去抓那个阿法贝塔的那一块东西，而并不是在那一个面呢？然后他就说，陈佳颖，你这样子我要去想很多。我说好，没关系，这样再说。
对啊，像我刚刚也有提到一句话，就是那个室内的太阳能板嘛。其实你找室内太阳能就会找到。对，那这个其实就是一个相当不同的，就是那一层的阻态会不一样。对，那甚至是连用这些电灯都可以一定程度把电流传到这个机器里面。对，
我在跟大家讲，就是说，如果当它小的地方可以去转这个的时候，那就可以慢慢改成大的东西出来。
对啊，对啊，对啊。
然后在这一块，你再把它去改成它里面的一个其中一个装置的话，那今天就会有不同的。
对啊，对啊，所以我是蛮建议，就有空了解一下，就是室内太阳能板的这个
室内太阳能板
的这个比较新的技术。
对，那如果像磁性的这一块，
对，
磁性装置跟那个水力装置这件事情，
对。因为你的磁性装置，你说如果要放在就是天然气管里面，
它是在套管外头。
OK。
因为像现在天然气，它现在的自从气爆之后，它是在每一个套管外面去抓，
对，
去抓它那个气，它有没有跑掉多少的那个部分。那如果是在外围在走气的那一块去做一个磁性连接，
因为磁性连接我们现在最常用的其实就是悠游卡嘛。就是那个进场通讯嘛，对。那进场通讯大概以就是因为泛称 RFID， 但事实上 NFC 是很短距离。那很短距离，其实现在手机也都有这种感应功能嘛。那这样确实你是中间不需要拉一条电线，也不需要拉一条传输线，对，就可以直接用就是磁场啦，就可以去进行通讯。但是因为你在讲的是特定的用途啦，管径啊什么的，对。那个因为我并没有先去了解天然气的那个，所以我没有办法当场算给你啦。
Okay.
对对，但是我是觉得确实。可以就是多少看一下目前的 NFC 技术它的发展的这个状态，那还有就是说在你讲的那个场景它的状态适不适用，那也许适用的话就可以测测看，因为 NFC 是很便宜的。对，
因为他们说你做什么很多事情，因为它像这个也是我们突然之间，
对对对，
然后我们来做吧，然后就突然决定来做这个，然后
就说这很好啊，
然后他就说，那你现在又跟我讲你做完这个，你又跟我讲好，你又想去做别的了。
对，
因为我觉得脑袋停下来就会变了。
理解理解，
对，
很棒啊，就是有发明的这种热情，
那就丢给别人。
理解理解理解理解，这很棒。
就全部丢给他，
okay.
然后他就说：“你一定要把你的那个弄天马行空丢给别人。”我说：“你有、你只要把问题丢出来，我有喜欢。
嗯，
我觉得应该说，我相信。”方法比问题多，但是要先把问题先全部丢出来。
就是什么是值得解决的了，这个先凝聚出来。
对，我说我们先把问题全部都找出来之后，然后再把它全部归类，然后再这样解决，这样才会快，然后才会在制作的时候再做那种动手再做 case 的，才不会有任何问题。然后我就说这样才会快，所以我就说，那我希望，说你接着我说，我只希望在这过程当中，我要看能不能找出什么。
对啊，我觉得这都很棒。其实刚刚他们外面不是在办活动嘛，他们在做的也是很有意思。他们是说，我们用电子账单，而不要用纸本账单。这些参与的银行把省下来的钱拿去给低收入的家户，让他们换成比较便宜有效率的 LED 照明。那这样的话，他就不会因为能源而贫穷，然后这边又可以减碳嘛。所以它就是一个商业模式。每一个单独的技术都不是新技术，但是它透过这样的方式让每个人发现说，哎，我这样子。造成的影响力甚至大过好比像说我不用塑胶吸管的那样子的对环境的影响力，所以我会建议说，如果你对这个有兴趣，可以多看我们这边叫社会创新嘛，因为叫 social design 社会设计这样子的概念，就是说我们让大家都有一种我在做公益的这个参与的角度，但是大家可以把本来彼此不认识根本不是没有在一起工作的这些部门把它结合起来，那这个比单一的这个工业的技术它能够扩张的范围又更广一点，又更广一点，有空的话也可以看看。
会往这个方向，因为我就跟他讲，我需要一点其他东西进来，我才会去继续想这些事情。
没问题。
然后我就说， 嗯，好啊。他说，因为你刚，我是在刚好在编写那个的时候，才去想说，哎，等一下，我好像想要做什么，然后才能丢给他说，哎，我想要再做那个其他。然后你只要做那个电板就好，不要再给我想说你要做什么
其他。理解。Okay. 所以我觉得就是说，我们以前都觉得说，可能自然科学，我们刚刚讲应用材料科学、工业应用都是科技嘛。但其实我刚刚讲这种社会科技、社会科学、社会设计的技术，其实也是一种技术。那种技术更不受材料科学的限制，它只是把你的点子讲清楚，然后大家就可以一起来应用。那我们总统媒体课中很多都是这个状况，有空也可以到网站上看看。
好，没问题。
好。
Do you have any suggestion for us how to continue?
I did make some suggestions around social design, social innovation,basically turning these purpose-oriented actions into something that everybody can participate. It's called crowdsourcing. Instead of just crowdfunding one specific industrial design from the ecosystem, maybe these very interesting ideas could be written up into more invitations for participation on saving energy together, on converting energy more efficiently together, making sure that people understand the more applications in the like infrastructure pipelines and things like that. And so just write it up and then share it with our ecosystem.
Okay, great.
Mm-hmm.
Cool, thank you.
Yeah. All right. I want to ask this, is it because of the nature of this part? Or is the gas is part? The gas part is already
That's right.
Mm.因为我们家会计师说，你碰什么都好，水跟火不要跟火。然后我说不会啊，我说明明那个我们家的那个他说，因为我们在我们老家在北投嘛，然后我就跟他讲说，我们那边有个焚化炉，然后用那个那种也可以发电。他说，然后就
是啊，确实，
对。然后妹就说已经在做，但是因为它的焚化量不够，所以没有办法去做到这
那个规模了。
对，他说那我说啊，那肯定是。白来的，他说不，我说你应该要有其他的想法，因为大家都一直讲说，那你焚化炉这样会造成空污，会干嘛？可是台湾已经在做的那种部分，就是在焚化的过程当中，你去做净化了。
对啊。
那
哦，对啊，已经有那种旋风喷射金炉，你烧金纸都不会造成污染。
对，我的意思是这样。然后我说这样讲，应该是说，在这过程当中。你如何再继续持续用这个料？然后我们说不，他不会，他绝对不会答应你。说为什么？他说因为你持续烧那个料，它就会造成的是那种对环境的一种伤害的地方在于温度。
了解。
他就说，那你这样的话，等于是在伤害在温度上面，等于是会让整个温度整个升高。他说你这样还是会还是有问题。这个我没有办法，我没有去想到大气层这个问题。
没关系啊，我们就一个一个试试看嘛。只要分享出来，说不定就会有人想出更好的一个。
对，我说你只要讲多少，然后我
新的做法。
对，然后你们只有出来说，那你不是说你只要问你哦？是啊，可是问题是我还没想到那里啊，我还没想到红利啊。然后我讲给我们家会计师听哦，啊不行，这个不能碰哦，为什么？哦，那个这两个那种钱都烧了太多了。
啊，了解。
对。
对了，但是 idea 分享出去不花钱嘛？
没有，因为他的意思是。因为他知道我说着说着就去做，
就会去做。
然后他就说，因为当我说着说着，只要对的点对了，我就去做了。因为他知道我的点就是，第一个就是安全，
对。
第二个就是平衡，
了解。
你如何一切是平衡的？然后第三个看方法等级，然后现在就等于第一个、第三个都有，但是再来就是第二个。然后我就问我们家会计师，会计师说哦。那个国立水利不能碰，其他还可以。
OK。
哦，好，那可以。然后就因为他们知道我的习性是说着说着就想去做，但是三个点只要对了，我就做了。问题是说还没有，就还不行做。
其实 idea 分享出来就不一定要花自己的钱了，有更多的想法的朋友，自己拿这个 idea 就去做了，就是也有点成功不必在乎那个味道。对，所以我觉得这个也是可以考虑。
好。
What is your opinion about the current pandemic and the outlook for what COVID is going to do?
To humanity?
To humanity.
I think this is the first time that the world, the planetary community, has the same topic of the same urgency. more so than energy transition, climate change, or anything which has an even urgency across different jurisdictions. There's the same urgency across the planet. So I guess this brings us a planetary solidarity, across time zones and so on. People actually have a positive experience of working on something together. And so we talk about decarbonization and so on. And so that may be the next few topics that we can then apply this intergenerational and cross-jurisdictional solidarity toward more structural ideas. So I'm highly optimistic about this planetary collaboration.
Do you think Taiwan is going to open up to the world travel again?
Definitely, yeah. I mean, part of this depends on our domestic vaccination schedule. And if we have a good, and it looks like we will, have good domestic produced vaccines, so much so that people feel safe and that we can also share it to other countries and to help them feel safe, then that will lead to much rapid opening up. So I think we'll know for sure around June, and we'll see how the domestic vaccination goes.
And what about the variations that are coming that are more increasingly not working on vaccines?
Yeah, that's part of the things that we need to determine, right, by June or July. If it's mRNA-based, then theoretically you can just plug and play the virus code and then guard against those so that the vaccine could upgrade faster than the virus could mutate. On the other hand, if the pandemic is still spreading, that leads to more potential mutations and maybe in a year or two, maybe if there's like two or three variants, each individually contagious and unable to be countered by vaccine to one another, then we have a larger problem, right? It's like a like overlapping flu thing, and that will complicate the current arrangement. So I think one of our main goal is just to get the world vaccinated as soon as possible so that the virus doesn't have chance to mutate into multiple incompatible but overlapping pandemics.
Okay. What about testing? What's your opinion about testing?
You mean RT-PCR and?
Rapid testing, just a point of entry.
Sure, it's quite useful. And I think that coupled with what we talk about, personal vaccination and personal test records and so on, I think that could facilitate more international travel. Mm-hmm. But on the other hand, if in either the origin or destination, still there's no herd immunity provided by initial vaccination, then it only reduces the risk but doesn't eliminate the risk. So some sort of quarantine would still be warranted. If we want to go fully quarantine free, then that still requires herd immunity on both sides, regardless of the testing regimen.
Are there any examples of herd immunity in existing
Israel?
Are there any examples of
Israel.
Herd immunity?
Israel, maybe. Well, we're looking at a real herd immunity in Israel, and in a couple other jurisdictions, thanks to the early vaccination. And I guess I should also mention Palau, right? Palau is my such jurisdiction.
Okay. In cooperation with that. Okay.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you.
Take care.
Yeah. Oh, man, I should give you my name card.
Sure.
Okay.
Cheers.